No teleprompter. Hello, friends. It is Masters Week. Will Jordan Spieth recover from the debacle on hole 12 last year to earn his second green jacket? Meanwhile, Tony Romo is hanging up the jersey and exchanging it for a different jacket. That's next.
I guess we'll get into it, guys. Always enthusiastic, unbelievable, hard-nosed.
What is it?
This Dallas team was very overrated from the start, like they always are every year.
The talent there, Evan Mack, Eric Davis, and Cohen Roach are maybe three of the most talented guys in the team.
Okay. Even though there's no problem.
That's an ugly shirt.
Always a pleasure having you on, guys.
Time to freak out, Reese.
Welcome in to College Crossfire. It is your live home for sports debate right here on the 40 Acres. I'm your host, Reese Miller. So glad to be with you and incredibly excited to have you along for the ride with us. It is Masters Week. We have a special Masters question block coming at you guys. A couple of golf experts and a first timer. We've got Luke Hendry. Luke, I know you're excited to hit the links yourself. How you doing, man?
It's good to be back, Reese. Doing real well.
Awesome, awesome. I'm excited. Haven't had any of you guys on in a while. Madison, special case for you, wearing the green. I like it, kind of in the spirit of it. I know you're not feeling well, but welcome to the show, your first time as well.
I'm glad to be here.
Awesome. James, bringing it, as always, the green jacket. Gosh, you're the best. What can I say?
You know what? I'm in high spirits, Reese. The Leafs are just on the verge of making the playoffs, and of course, Masters Week. Doesn't get any better than this.
An incredible week. Let's go ahead and kick it off. Right here, last year, Jordan Spieth was six holes in a five-stroke lead ahead from his second consecutive Masters Championship, but it slipped away. Seven strokes later on hole 12, eventually Danny Willett ended up donning the green jacket. Spieth finished second, first, and second in his last three trips to Augusta National. Basically the biggest collapse maybe the entire sports world last year, guys. The question is, you know, he did win a few tournaments, is playing okay. Can he rebound from the same place where maybe the biggest collapse of his career happened last year, Luke?
No one's going to forget, and especially Jordan Spieth, what happened over that 155-yard stretch at Amen Corner. In fact, when you look at Jordan Spieth, it is a disaster that he will forever have to carry with him throughout his career. But one thing about Jordan Spieth that makes him different than a lot of PGA Tour professionals is his weathered veteran personality. He's 23 years old, and yet he has the ability to bounce back better than just about any guy on the PGA Tour. You look at what he did last year after he made the 7 on number 12. He birdies 13, pars 14, birdies 15, and left himself with inside 10 feet on 16 for birdie. He almost came back and won that tournament, Reese. And that's the bounce back in ability of Jordan Spieth. If he was able to bounce back last year, he can bounce back this year. He's got confidence. He can overcome anything. He can overcome a mistake last season. He'll play well this week.
Yeah, Spieth apparently went and played three different rounds on Augusta National, birdied every time he was at that hole. Feels like it's behind him. Madison, what do you think? You think it's behind him, or he's still got some demons to deal with there?
You know, for Spieth, it's all about having a good mindset. If he's in the right mind, he can really do it. Last year, after hitting that ball into the creek, fans thought he was going to bounce back and be able to recover from it. But after the second time, you know, I think it really messed with his mind and caused him some issues. So he just really has a good mental state. He stays focused. He has a good attitude. Doesn't let things get in his way. He's definitely going to have a good year. And possibly his second shot at winning the Masters for the second time.
So all in the mind, you think? Good attitude,
all in the
good
mind,
results.
For sure.
I like that. Very positive thinking. James, always tough when you rinse not one, but two balls with a five-stroke lead. How do you think he recovers this weekend?
Now, first, I do want to say number 12 is a notoriously difficult hole. And that second shot, the drop shot, you see guys put it in the water all the time. That downhill lie doesn't help. However, with a guy like Jordan Spieth, I think you'll know within the first 24 hours whether or not he will come back and win the tournament. What differentiates him from the pack is his putting. And with different conditions than he's used to, a couple drier years over the past few, it's going to be a little bit more damp. So we'll have to see. I think putting is going to be the key. If he can roll in a few on the first day, I say he's back to normal. And all those demons that caught on to him on Sunday won't be there anymore.
Yeah, without a doubt, you talk about Dustin Johnson. He's got the best driver in the game, Rory as well. Spieth's big weapon is the putter. Luke, I think I'm going with you here. There just seems to be something different about Spieth, the way he deals with adversity, his cool demeanor, and he's won it before. It's not like he's not been able to get it and he's still looking for his first. So I think he may have a chance at getting that second one this weekend. And the task may have just gotten a little bit easier. Dustin Johnson officially announced he is, well, questionable for the tournament at this point of the juncture. Fell downstairs, guys, this morning. Fell downstairs after the par 3 contest was rained out. His agent says he's not totally ruled out from play beginning tomorrow. Guys, this is huge. The heavy favorite, the number one golfer in the world, had won 3 straight tournaments, looking to be the first golfer since Tiger in the last 25 years to win 4 straight tournaments. If he's unable to play, or even if he is, but not 100%, Madison, how do you think this changes the outlook of the weekend for everybody else, and who do you think rises up?
I definitely think it changes the outlook, and for a lot of people, makes him a little bit more comfortable, not as much as of competition. He's definitely someone that, like I said, gets into a lot of people's heads with his talent and his good playing consistency. He's got some records. I mean, he's a good player, and someone that rises up, I think Spieth now has an even better chance at winning, not as much competition.
Yeah, maybe the biggest favorite. I think everybody was riding that DJ train, and then this amazing news comes down for everybody else today, James. What do you think? Is there another guy that can rise up?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it was time for Dustin Johnson to put on the green jacket. I didn't necessarily think that it would be this time. It's so hard to win consecutive tournaments, not to mention 4 in a row, which is what it would be if he won this weekend. So I've been looking to Jason Day, who just shoved off some really, really powerful demons that we talked about earlier. His mom had been diagnosed with terminal cancer, and they just got some good prognosis this week. A good prognosis this week about how she might have a longer time with us, and she might even be able to beat cancer. So I think with that story behind him, I think Jason Day can be a favorite. The Masters, Augusta National, loves a good story. Guys like Angel Cabrera and Fred Couples always seem to show up in tournaments like these, and I could see Jason Day, who's been really close before, pushing over the edge this time.
At one point, the number one golfer in the world coming into this tournament a season ago, of course, coming off the win at ACC Dell Match Play, unfortunately found out the news this year. So what a story it would be. Luke, how does the DJ injury change things headed into the weekend, and who's a guy that could step up?
DJ's presence is felt not as much as what Tiger's was in the early 2000s, but it was getting close. 3 straight wins, hottest player on tour, world number one. If he can play, great. If he can't, it opens up a field for a lot of players. Now, you can go a safe route and pick Jordan Spieth, Rory McIlroy, or even Jason Day. But a guy I like that I'm going to take dead aim on tonight is the guy who reps Puma all week long. That's Ricky Fowler.
Wow.
He showed vulnerability last week at the Show Houston Open. He missed the cut at Augusta a season ago, so why pick him? Well, he's a birdie maker, and that's what is going to be key this week. The forecast Thursday and Friday are heavy winds. Mistakes are going to be made on a difficult golf course like Augusta National. The only way to offset bogeys and doubles is with birdies. Ricky Fowler can do that. He's 7th in birdies this season on the PGA Tour. I like Ricky slipping on the green jacket on Sunday.
Wow, bold. And I like Ricky Fowler too. I always like Ricky Fowler. And then somehow he always seems to either disappoint me or rise above my expectations. So inconsistent. James, you mentioned the great story. Nothing would be better than Jim Nance, of course, having the final call, the terrific story to end it. I hope it ends that way as well, James. You're getting the points. Moving on, and to the man who will be joining Jim Nance in the broadcast booth. After a month of waiting to see which team would take Tony Romo, we have our answer. Number 9 is hanging up the jersey and trading it in for a sport coat and a headset. Romo retires from football to be the number one CBS analyst on Sundays, replacing Phil Sims. Romo is the 4th rated passer in NFL history, the all-time leader in touchdowns and passing yards for the Dallas Cowboys. But what is the legacy he leaves behind? James, we'll begin with you.
Now, Tony Romo, a story like him could not end with just a season of injuries
and then
Dak Prescott taking over. And that's why I think, or I know, I found the prophecy of Tony Romo, and it is far from over. So here before you, I read the words of the prophecy. In the final game before the Super Bowl of 2018, the Dallas Cowboys found themselves one touchdown away from returning to the epicenter of their existence where prophets like Jimmy Johnson and Troy Aikman laid their legacy. But as Dak Prescott fell from a thunderous collision, Jason Garrett could only look to one man. A footballing Hercules, born with the facial features of Ryan Reynolds and the heart of Rocky Balboa, floated down from the broadcast booth in shimmering silver-winged glory to take one last snap. And the aged Italian hero grabbed the ball, looked off a wide-open Desmond Bryant, and stormed toward the end zone. He knocked through five different tackles and stood in the promised land, but he forgot one precious item, the ball. And the story of Tony Romo ended one step short, just as it always had, away from immortality.
Yeah. Wow, we need a clap. We need some claps from the audience. Jeez.
Tony Romo.
Incredible.
They're not my words.
You know what? They want a point right there. I'm going to go ahead and give you a point. I'll still award out another point for this question, but the effort, the essence of that was amazing and fitting as well. Wow. A lot to live up to, Luke, but what do you think is the legacy, Tom Jerome?
Yeah, James, I didn't come across any prophecies, unfortunately, before the show tonight. But if you look at Tony Romo, his career is as a juxtaposing as it gets for an NFL quarterback. He's one of the greatest regular season quarterbacks of all time. From 2006 to 2013, he had the highest passing rating of any quarterback in the fourth quarter. He could close games except when it mattered in the playoffs. Zero Super Bowls, zero NFC championships, and only two playoff wins in 2009 and 2014. He will always be remembered as a good quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. He does lack success in the postseason, but his likability and charisma will last forever, and he'll be able to bring that with the broadcasting career that he's in. Going into.
Yeah, I think you said it well. The most enigmatic, polarizing player maybe in the last 20 years in the NFL, and I think he knows that's part of his legacy going out. Madison, what do you think of old number 9 here?
You know, I think really moving to CBS, that's the best possible move that he can make. But he is definitely going to go down as a player that has definitely made history. He's a Cowboys franchise leader in passing yards and passing touchdowns. He's really climbed up the ladder since he was originally a free agent back in 2003, and he will for sure go down in history.
Yeah, Madison, I think I'm going to give you some points. You got the undrafted free agent, really a guy that wasn't even supposed to be an NFL quarterback, then couldn't quite exceed the expectations he set for himself. And I guess speak for all Cowboy fans, thank you, Tony, for what you did. We will always miss watching you, no matter what everybody thought. Madison is getting the point going to break. We will be right back. Welcome back to College Crossfire, your home for live sports debate. We thank you so much for sticking with us. Of course, we mentioned earlier in the show, Madison Hildreth, her first time on the show, not feeling so well. She has got to take a little bit of a break. Hopefully, she'll be back for rapid fire. So, we got the bro show officially, the three fellas hanging out on Masters Week. Bro show, I'm glad you guys are here. Quick scoreboard update, Luke had 1 point. Madison had 1 point as well. James in the lead either way with two from the epic Romo prophecy that I wish could have turned out differently, guys. Gonzaga certainly wished their game could have turned out differently on Monday night. The North Carolina Tar Heels won their sixth national title, taking down the Zags in a tight game, came down close to the wire, but that doesn't mean it was necessarily a good game. 44 fouls and 52 free throws pretty much surmised what went on with the officials and in that game. The question remains, was this game actually good? Was it actually entertaining, and how did the refs affect it? The refs have been really ripped apart here throughout this entire tournament. How do you think they affected the title game, Luke?
Reese, I think you have to kind of step back and look at sporting events as a whole. Umpires, rules officials, referees have a say, and it's human discretion in every sporting event, and it's part of it. Good calls are going to be made. Bad calls are going to be made. There's no doubt that there was a lot of fouls called on Monday night in Phoenix, but I think when you look at the game as a whole, to take away from the quality of basketball, to take away from UNC's victory would be wrong, because refs are simply doing their job. And they're doing it to their best ability, and it's their discretion. It's part of the game. It's a 40-minute basketball game. Refs are going to do their job, and that's the story.
Yeah, it really seemed to slow the entire pace down. Wasn't much of a flow. And granted, two really good defensive teams, two teams in the top 10 of defensive efficiency rating. Mm-hmm. James, what do you think here? You think the refs kind of overstepped their bounds?
Well, I know that everyone in this room understands my history with the refereeing community. Projectiles have been thrown.
No helmets on the basketball court, though. No helmets on the basketball
You better watch out. I might throw this thing at somebody if someone says something wrong. No, but in all honesty, I find the refs, especially at the highest level, to be an extremely narcissistic group of people. And I find, especially in championship games, the ones who aren't as good as, say, others, make it about themselves. And that was a classic example of it happening once again. And I think it's plaguing sports all over the place. Soccer, you see it all the time. Guys like Mark Clattenburg who style their hair and play a game of charades with the crowd. Yes. The same kind of stuff happens here. And I think it was really unfortunate, not necessarily in terms of the end of the game, but people, millions and millions of people who tuned in to see great basketball weren't afforded that opportunity.
And it was still the highest rated game in a Monday night title game in history of CBS for college basketball, up about 20% from the ratings last year because it was two big time basketball schools. But I agree with both you guys, James. I think I'm going to give you the point here just because I think at a certain level, we don't want to watch referees make that big of an impact on the game. We don't want to watch free throws. We want to watch three pointers. We want to watch dunks.
And here's the thing with a ref. A ref goes into a game like this thinking, I have to have the best game of my life. Yeah. And I think that mentality is somewhat misplaced. And I think it was especially misplaced in this game.
Well, all right, you're getting the points. Moving onward. Major League Baseball season is underway. 3 days so far. The Texas Rangers still don't even have their first win. The Astros are undefeated. And, well, Bryce Harper is still terrific on opening days. Guys, what is your biggest impression from Monday to sort of kick off the baseball season and get it going here as we're 3 days in now? James, we'll start with you.
Oh, I'm so excited I get the start. Now, there's only so much you can take away from a baseball game this early in the season. And I wasn't sure if I was going to go about it with a story like David Price and what it could mean for the Red Sox long term, or go in a different direction, the Cubbies, perhaps. No, Scott Piscotty is the man here. Now, Stephen Piscotty. I thought of Scott Sterling. Do we have the video? Do we have the audio?
Yes. No.
There's one. Got him once.
Here we go. Stephen, as I like to call him, Scott, gets beamed right there in the elbow. And check out this throw. Boom, and right in the same elbow. Literally right in the same elbow. Just when you thought it couldn't get any funnier, as he storms toward home. Yep, you guessed it. A shot right to the dome.
Oh.
Did the run count? Who cares? He got hit 3 times. That is always hilarious. And thank you, thank you, thank you to the MLB for providing something beautiful like this in opening week.
In the face.
In the face.
In the face. Wow, incredible. Very reminiscent of Scott Sterling. Madison. Welcome back to the show. So glad you're back with us. Hope you're having a better time than Stephen Piscotty was.
Yes.
Less injuries, I hope. I'll ask you the same question. Impressions of opening day.
You know, there was a lot to watch out for. The Red Sox, you know, facing some of the same struggles they faced last year. Pirates not doing so well. However, on the flip side, there were some good performances from some of those key players, such as Bryce Harper with the 2 home runs, making it his 5th career home run. And we also have people like Mark Trumbo with his historic walk-off in the 11th inning. So that was something definitely to watch out for. So most of those really good, solid performances coming from those individuals.
Yeah,
players.
For sure. Feels good to have baseball, just have games going every night. Madison, love the effort. Appreciate you coming back and joining us. I'm giving you a point. I'm feeling generous as we move along. Luke, impressions.
Opening day, let me tell you, so many people start making these season-long assertions and, oh, the Cubs are 0-1 and they don't have a chance. But opening day is just a day in baseball, and I think the story for me was the Toronto Blue Jays-Baltimore Orioles opening game. Last season, the Orioles lost to a walk-off homer in the AL wildcard game. This year, the Orioles returned the favor to the Blue Jays as Trumbar hits one out of the park in the 11th inning to win 3-2 over the Jays. Great revenge for the Baltimore Orioles. Great way to start their season after a disappointing exit last year.
Absolutely.
And I also have to mention, we're just a few days closer and watching the last season of Bryce Harper in a Nationals uniform. Just a few days closer to the $450 million Yankee contract that's
pleasant
coming his way.
Pleasant reminder. Wow, a shot at Bryce Harper. You had the Stephen Piscotty, a Scott Sterling reference. Madison gets the points for effort.
Oh, no.
You get the point for as well being awesome on that question. We're headed to break. We're going to light up rapid fire and decide a winner. That's next. It is 24/7 time on TSTV. That means no breaks, 24 hours, 7 days a week. We hope you can donate, of course, to our cause here. And live television means some mistakes, some live action here. Had one more question ready to go, teed up. Last block, we're going to go ahead and move it into this block right up y'all's alley. We're talking Olympics. We're talking hockey as well. Guys, basically, this block, we're just going to make it four rapid-fire questions. First time we've ever done that, so make it a little history of yourself. So, Madison, basically the way this works is I'll throw out a question. You jump in at any time, and the points are now doubled from 1 to 2. Guys, the NHL announced it was not sending players to the 2018 Winter Olympic Games. Fans, of course, are obviously not happy. Hockey stars have been a staple of previous Olympic Games for really the last 40 years. Guys, what do you think of the move? What kind of impact does it have on the game of hockey? If Gary Bettman could get any less liked by people, I think he just did.
Who wants to start this off?
Any of you guys jump in?
I think, Reese, one of the biggest things is viewership. People want to see the greatest athletes play. And that's the same when it goes with USA basketball. It's the same with Olympic tennis. It's the same with Olympic soccer. It's the same with every Olympic sport that has a professional league at the elite level. And that's the NHL for hockey. People want to see the players that are recognizable, that are notable, and that have status. And if the fans can't watch them, who's going to be interested in Olympic hockey if it's AAA, AA, and 1A players out there competing for their country? People want to see the best players play, and that's evident across Olympic sports.
Yeah, people need their Sidney Crosby. They need Patrick Kane. They need stars, and I think that's what it's going to be missing. James, you know, the American Hockey League, the AHL, if that's where players are coming from, it's not going to do as well. It's not the same product.
Yeah, I mean, look, the 1980 story with a bunch of college kids is a great story, but the fact of the matter is Russia is going to be icing a real good team in a couple years. This is a big hit. This is a big hit for not just Olympic hockey, but American hockey. We are just about to see two of the best American players to ever play the game, Jack Eichel and Austin Matthews, put on the red, white, and blue for the first time. This is a chance to dethrone Canada. And not to mention, I think this is the best Olympic team sport there is to offer in terms of competitiveness. So they'll be back, but the NHL is trying to make a statement here, and I just don't think it's worth it.
What do you even think the point of all this is? What is there to gain?
Well, they just brought in the World Cup of Hockey, which is kind of their attempt at a World Cup in soccer. But the problem is, if you have a team called the Young Guns and Team Europe, you're never going to be a legitimate tournament.
Yeah. Madison, what do you think here? It feels like we're going to be missing out on a lot come 2018.
You know, it is hard. I'm going to start by looking at the pros, though. We saw that the IOC is not funding travel and insurance to the teams as much as they did in the past years. Also, there's going to be a decrease in the amount of injuries, so more players will be able to actually see regular season. But on the other side of that, it's going to hurt hockey as a whole. This was their chance to really showcase not only the sport, but the key players. So not having them on that international stage is going to hurt the sport as a whole. So ultimately, it does more damages than it does help them.
Yeah, you mentioned injuries, World Cup. We're talking about that. Jamie Benn and Tyler Seguin, two of the best Dallas Stars, both injured to start the year because of playing World Cup of Hockey. James, I think I'm giving you the 2 points here. I just feel like this hurts the game. I don't think it helps it near as much as it hurts it. Everyone wants to watch the Olympics. They want to watch the best stars and then carry that back over into the NHL. Guys, from an ice rink to a racetrack, NASCAR races into Texas Motor Speedway this weekend, but this time it's a little bit different. The 26th race in Fort Worth. The racetrack has changed. They have repaved it. They have redesigned it. The banking has been adjusted. So my question to you, you're going to put your racetrack owner's caps on. James, you look like you're ready to go for that right now. And you guys get to design your own racetrack. Just tell me what you would have it, what kind of obstacles, if any, what kind of terrain. But NASCAR cars have to race on it.
Wow, I just heard the funniest comment ever, have them turn right. I think that is incredible. So Josh should get the point here, but I will say I think that you just design it based off Super Mario. You go, I want loops and I want speed boosts. I want both.
Speed boosts.
We need speed boosts.
Wow, we hear a Rainbow Road over there.
Rainbow
Road
might be a little
treacherous. I would watch NASCAR Rainbow Road, for sure.
It could get a little treacherous in space, but I
think Jeff Gordon would naturally dominate, but
of course.
That's besides the point.
I think setting cost aside, I'd like to see an underwater race. You can incorporate, you can incorporate Mario Kart. You can have a track underwater. I think it'd bring excitement. I think it would challenge the competitors. Obviously, they'd have to have oxygen.
It would be a challenge,
question. Oxygen-enabled vehicles. So I think it'd create an atmosphere around NASCAR for, you know, not just those in the southeast of the United States.
Right.
Beautiful.
Right. NASCAR fans would have to find a way to get their different type of liquid down in the track
That's a great point.
Madison, what do you think?
I'm going to go for more just the location. I'd like to move it to a place like Hawaii, a super tropical, place, and just get a straight shot. Just have the cars go straight the whole entire time.
Straight speed.
Right into the ocean.
I like that.
Exactly.
I'll tell you, I love Mario Kart, but I also love underwater. It's hard to beat that. Maybe get little spaceship things, make them multi-terrain. Yeah, get some Spy Kids. God, they'd win. They'd smoke Jeff Gordon or Tony Stewart or whoever is still going there, guys. Very quick on this one. Derek Jeter, along with possibly Jeb Bush, is looking to buy the Miami Marlins. Really quickly, guys, what athlete do you want to buy your favorite team?
Wait, so what athlete?
Yeah, it can be any athlete. You want to buy your team, any former athlete.
I mean, I'm taking my man, the big Swede, who currently is on Manchester United. He literally just compared himself to a lion yesterday.
Wow.
Zlatan Ibrahimovic, he's my guy. 6'5" Swede with a man bun all day.
Incredible. Real quick, what do you guys have?
I'd go, if I could go back in time, actually, and it's Masters Week, so why not give a little tribute to Arnie Palmer?
Wow, Arnie.
He was an ambassador for golf. He'd be an ambassador for any team. He has a charisma and ability to handle press, but he would also know the role of an owner, and that's the ability to remove yourself from the success of the team. I think he'd be a great owner.
Very fitting on this Masters Week. Madison, what do you think?
I am going to go with none other than Dak Prescott. Favorite
On the day that Romo was returned.
But he's also my neighbor, lives right behind me, so that could work out, help a little bit. For sure, Dak, though.
Wow. Incredible. Arnold Palmer is incredibly fitting. I'm going to give you the points, but James had built up a big enough lead. He is our winner. Only fitting that the man in the green jacket would take it home.
I thought I was
going
to have to give
Masters
this out to
week.
Else.
You get to pick the meals today. Oh. Got to pick the meals yesterday as well. And next year, we hope you'll be back not only next week, but maybe next year.
Yeah, we'll see.
Moving on, guys. That will do it for this week in a College Crossfire. We're here live every Wednesday night at 9. Press Box, our sister show, live Mondays at 9:30. Keep up with us on social media at TSTV Sports. James Grachos, the man in the green jacket, is your winner. Terrific job by the panelists. Great job by Madison for sticking it out. Huge thank you to everyone in studio and Master Control for making this all thing happen. Special thanks to you for spending your Wednesday night with us. Until next time, have a fantastic week.